A lot of Americans are using gender pronouns differently. This is pretty simple, or it was in the past, she, he, him, her. But many people are embracing what they see as a more inclusive way of speaking, using gender-neutral pronouns like they and them for people who are gender non-binary and don't associate female or male. This is, in fact, changing workplace norms in many places, but that shift can be tricky, NPR's Yuki Noguchi reports.
As a child, Joshua Byron realized dressing up as Princess Leia was unconventional for a boy. It wasn't until young adulthood that Byron first encountered the concept that someone could identify as something other than male or female. The idea of being gender neutral, or part one, part the other, felt like it fit. So Byron, who's 24, came out as gender non-binary to friends 3 years ago. Byron wanted to be referred to in the third person as they or them, as in they, meaning Byron, asked their friends to honor their wish. But they didn't feel comfortable asking the same of people at work.
I had a very supportive friend group, and then I would sort of go to work and I would not think about that part of myself.
That changed 2 years ago after Byron applied for a teaching job in New York. A reference outed Byron as non-binary. The new employer had no problem with it and hired Byron. But being out at work meant fielding endless questions from colleagues. Is this really a thing? How can a plural pronoun refer to one person? As well as more invasive personal inquiries.
I think people feel really intense about it. You know, like, especially who don't understand it, feel like, how can this be? How can this be? Or like, this is breaking some rule.
Norms about gender have been changing. Studies show more people, especially young people, identify as something other than male or female. Some employers are already shifting policies. United Airlines gives customers the option to identify as non-binary when booking tickets. Retirement company TIAA instructed employees to introduce themselves to clients with their preferred pronouns. The law firm Baker McKenzie earlier this year benchmarked its staffing targets to 40% men, 40% women, and 20% flexible, including non-binary people. Anna Brown, the firm's director of global diversity and inclusion, says the policy is designed to reflect the shifting demographics.
These are prospective policies. And as we go forward, we know we have non-binary colleagues.
And some workers themselves are making changes, doing things like including their pronouns on business cards and email signatures. That can raise eyebrows, and sometimes coworkers don't understand what the pronouns are referring to. Laura Jacobs, a New York psychotherapist, says these changes are new and somewhat rare.
How to handle non-binary people is still something that I don't think most employers really have a sense for how to handle.
Jacobs counsels many transgender and non-binary individuals. Personally, Jacobs identifies as both. That's right, Jacobs identifies as either he, she, or they. Jacob says the workplace is still a very gendered place.
Challenging moments that the person has to deal with can start right from the application process.
Employment forms, for example, often include only two checkboxes, male or female. References from old jobs might be unaware of a new name or gender identity. And often, Jacob says, employer health insurance requires a person to choose.
You had to be binary in order to get care, and that was enforced by the medical community, the legal community, and so on.
And then there were the inappropriate questions from coworkers.
Everybody wonders what's in our pants.
Nowhere does this get more personal than the bathroom. For transgender populations, bathrooms are places associated with uncomfortable staring, harassment, and even violence. They've also been at the center of political controversy. 3 years ago, North Carolina passed a law requiring people to use bathrooms corresponding to their assigned gender at birth. That law was struck down. But Mark Marson says bathrooms remain a hot-button issue for employers and for coworkers who don't feel comfortable sharing bathrooms with transgender people. Marson is director of human resources at Allies for Health and Well-Being, a community health clinic. He recently participated in an online discussion with other HR executives about making the workplace gender neutral.
A good 60, if not more, percent of the conversation was about bathrooms.
At the time, Marson says, he was rethinking his company's restroom policies. In the process, he was also educating himself about the sensitivities of people who are gender non-binary.
I quote-unquote forced myself to go into what was the women's bathroom, and I realized it doesn't matter.
Marson realized a bathroom is just a bathroom. He ended up relabeling them simply restroom and restroom with urinals. From a worker's perspective, this change can signal acceptance. For Joshua Byron, it's a central emotional issue.
Oh, bathrooms, God. Yeah, I mean, that's a big one.
Byron's current workplace offers gender-neutral bathrooms, but many do not. And for Byron, things like restroom labels and dress codes become a litmus test for how their manager might react, how strictly masculinity might be enforced. But changing long-held gender paradigms isn't easy. The terms used by non-binary people can be difficult to understand. In fact, it can be confusing even for people who identify as non-binary. Take Mish DePiro. DePiro prefers they and them pronouns, but this is where it gets complicated. DePiro recently met someone who used both female and non-binary pronouns. DePiro stumbled in conversation, interchanging they, them, she, and her.
I don't think they took offense, but like it was an embarrassing moment for myself.
DePiro is 25 and works as a teacher in Seattle. Among middle school students, DePiro says gender norms have already changed. One student recently called DePiro by the wrong pronoun.
They felt like, oh, this is something that I grew up with that I should know not to mess up.
And as young people join the workforce, they will likely keep pushing for workplace culture to change even more. Yuki Noguchi, NPR News, Washington.
Black brother. Black brother to hell.
81 counts fill a 22-page civil lawsuit filed in federal court against Warren Mayor Jim Fouts and former police commissioner Jerry Green. The suit accusing them of creating a racially hostile work environment and retaliating against an employee.
There was a culture, pattern, and practice of racism, discrimination, and sweeping racial conduct under the rug.
The suit filed Monday says the city's first African-American diversity and inclusion coordinator, Gregory Murray, hired to investigate past racial and gender issues in the city, suffered racial discrimination himself and was then retaliated against.
Because Mr. Murray was stymied in his attempts to address these civil rights violations and illegal activity, he was stopped from doing his job and basically let go.
The suit says the major issues had been in the fire and police departments, but the complaint also highlighting Fouts' alleged comments over the years. Fouts accused of calling black people the N-word and chimpanzees and making derogatory comments about women and others. Controversial audio recordings surfacing many times, allegedly, of Fouts.
This is bottom of the bill. They're late to retarded people, and I don't want to be around them. I wished him well in a cage.
Fouts says he feels blindsided by the lawsuit and offended that he and the city attorney never received a copy of the complaint.
If you're going to accuse someone of something or you're going to file a lawsuit, that person should receive your complaint first, not last.
The idea that he's blindsided is absurd. Why don't you go talk to his attorney that he hired to represent him in this same case?
Fouts also says Murray was never fired. He says he made some demands like higher pay that they couldn't agree on, and he resigned. Fouts says he finds it, quote, appalling to attack the city's fire and police departments, calling the suit an election year gimmick.
It's a frivolous lawsuit designed to disparage the election process, and also designed to extort money from the city of Warren.
But Gregory Murray's attorney, Jonathan Marco, says he can't wait to see what comes of the lawsuit with some, quote, subpoena power. People reaching out to him already with additional information.
More to come. Absolutely. Stay tuned.
In Warren, Erica Erickson, Fox 2 News.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Friday, October 18th, 2019. So I have been told. The mayor said he has been blindsided. Another reason right there why we have no metaphors on the compensatory call-in. That's tomorrow. But that right there, blindsided. He's been hit by a Mack truck. By these allegations that he called the niggers, chimps and niggers in the workplace. Anyway, this here is neutralizing workplace racism. If we have any non-white people, victims of racism in the known universe, you have figured out how not to be called a chimp on the job. They don't mess over your schedule. You don't have any problems with pronouns. No confusion there either. You have got all of that solved. You get all of your raises on time. If you need a day off, a week off, it's not a problem. You don't have any restroom issues. All of that is taken care of. You are not accused of anything by your employer. Please dial in and share with us in great detail. How did you accomplish this? The number 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Right on. Certainly, any of the folks, if you have problems, if you are being called a chimp in the workplace, or any other racial slurs, racist slurs, I think last week we discussed urine in the workplace, any of those problems, as always, dial in. Hopefully we can offer some counter-racist suggestions, or at least a counter-racist way of processing what's happening, and a way to go about solving the problem without creating new problems. That is always the standard. But you're certainly welcome to dial in if you have a issue and you would like feedback. So much to share today for workplace racism. Wow. Before I get to other people that wrote in, email is untiljustice@gmail.com. If you have, if you're not able to dial in via the phone and you would like to share or you have suggestions to offer, you can email untiljustice@gmail.com. So many things to share before we get to the callers and everything. The audio segments, fascinating. I already mentioned Mayor Fouts and the accusations have a code. That might be. They had the recordings there. They said there were several different recordings that have come out over the past year or so. And the mayor is still holding down his job. And the victims of racism are still alleging that they've been abused and that this widespread abuse. Nothing that should be that surprising. Mayor, police department, fire department, any of the above. Be prepared. Standard operating procedure. The first segment. Wow. So Mr. Fuller has the quote. The gay rights movement is changing everything. I would be curious if there are any folks who in their work environment where you've had these type of changes, either, I don't know, training sessions, dealing with issues of pronouns and identity, sexual identity, sexual orientation, whatever the new labels that are being incorporated. I don't know if people have had any sort of talks addressing those matters in the workplace, but that would be interesting, especially if you're in an environment where they don't have any sort of dialogue about white supremacy, racism, or if they do, to compare and contrast. Again, I cannot think of examples of them talking about in detail black males and black females having workplace issues. I'll hear them talk about black females. I just saw a segment within the last 48 hours. On women of color in the workplace and the barriers that they face, but problems that black males and black females face in the workplace and that just being addressed in all the different areas of activity, I just don't see the same level of reporting and the same level of enthusiasm as we heard in that segment on the pronouns for non-binary gender identifying individuals. With that, I have encountered that not in a workplace setting, but the times that I have encountered it, I generally just go to calling people what they want to be called, and I end up just calling these individuals by their name. There's some individuals at the co-op who, you know, have some of these pronouns and what have you, And wow, it's so confusing for me. I just cut out all of that and just call them by their name and leave it there. That way, what did you say your name was? Terry? And we just go there. And it just becomes Terry. We just won't use the pronouns at all. Terry said, as opposed to he, she, them, they, all of that. Terry said such and such and such. Give this to Terry. Terry, all of that. Thank you. I would normally say like, thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Terry. That's what it becomes to avoid confusion with all of that, because you can get in a lot of trouble. Let's see. If folks have experience with that, please share. Wow. So much to share. Let's see. I guess I'll go with me. I mentioned last week, or even before I get to that, I played a little bit of Mr. Fuller talking about workplace racism before we got started. And sometimes I'll just randomly pick something that's older of him talking about workplace issues specifically to play before this broadcast starts each week. And this week, I played a segment and he was talking about his time working with the United States Treasury. And he said that someone there, one of his employees, said, you know, hey, Fuller, you know, I hear you got this, you know, radical book here. And I don't know, do the people know that you wrote this here book? And you heard, or I don't know if you did, if you were listening early. But he said, you know, I hope so. With the United States government, we had to get security clearance like they should. And I've heard him talk on more than one occasion about, hey, we are in a system of white supremacy racism. Is that true? Yes or no? What part of my book is false? And just standing by your work, even in the workplace, and, you know, being fearless. I know that's not everyone's code, but that did play before we aired today. So I think last week I mentioned, or I've talked about it at least last week and maybe a little bit before, that I got this internship for teaching yoga, that I wanted to teach more. We're doing the Cows Yoga Retreat, Florida, $200, knocked off the price, was able to find cheaper lodging, $730, the total price for the retreat. That is December 28th to January 1, 5 days, 4 nights, lodging included. We'll have plant-based meals every day prepared by Chef Nadira, yoga every day, counter-racist workshops, food workshops as well. The deposit, $380 due next week. Final deposit, $350, not due until the second week of December. But the total price dropped down to $730 for the Cows Retreat. I'll let folks know as we run out of space. But I wanted to do more teaching. That was why I got this internship. I wanted to get more opportunities to teach, to practice refining my craft. And it's right very close to my residence. I said, why not? I could add that to my resume as well. So a month or so into the internship, I taught two classes. And the white female instructor, she said, hey, you've been doing great with the internship. Your teaching has been great. You should get paid for doing the work. Let's go about filling the application process, background check, references, all of that. Review your work history. Now, I'm already thinking, hope I can find, you know, 5 people, 6 people to say something good about Gus T. I don't know if we've talked about that before with references, but whoo, man, I think I had mentioned that last week. We were having audio problems last week. I was so upset right when I was about to disclose some of this, so people might not have been able to hear what I was relaying, but quite a few references were required. And in the system of white supremacy, as a victim of racism, I feel like people generally do not have nice things to say about me and or black people in general. I look at the way President Obama's talked about. I look at the way Michelle Obama, when she was first lady, the way she was talked about. You could just go on down the list, the way Jay-Z has talked about, the way Serena Williams has talked about, the way LeBron James has talked about, the way I heard Dr. Welsing talked about. Just insert the name of, you know, any black person in the way that they are talked about, treated. On a, Elijah Cummings, the late United States congressman, insert name, you know. So I said, man, I am not sure. They'll say something connected to racism or, you know, I don't know. Anyway, so that was one, and particularly someone who would say something nice to a white person, suspected racist. So I go through the process. I would like to teach more, could add that on my resume as well. So I go through the process, get my references together, go through my work history, which, you know, for the last 10 years would have to include the C.O.W.S and my work as a journalist, writing, doing the podcast about white supremacy, racism. So fill out all of the information, and even stopping from there, I think I mentioned it before, my standard uniform for almost the entirety. It'll be 2 years at the end of the year, basically. Basically, C.O.W.S yoga retreat would be my 2 year anniversary of practicing yoga, would be the C.O.W.S yoga retreat, if there is such a thing. Anyway, the entire time almost that I've been practicing here in Seattle, I have worn my C.O.W.S t-shirt to almost every class, and I have taken about 1,000 public studio classes, probably more than that at this point, but about 1,000 public studio classes. Wearing some version of the "Please Treat Me Like I Am a White Person" t-shirt. And it does have the C.O.W.S logo on the front of the shirt. So I am not exactly, you know, hiding my affiliation with the broadcast. There are no secrets in the system of racism, white supremacy. As the only Negro in yoga classes, I stick out anyway. And whites have made that painfully obvious throughout my yoga practice. And it's my conclusion that nobody networks better than whites collectively, and the white people in the yoga community in Seattle, no different. You see very quickly that they know a lot of the other instructors, and they talk, and they're on Instagram and all the other social media outlets talking and posting, and a lot of the instructors teach at multiple studios and or they practice at multiple studios. So and it's, you know, it's kind of a small group anyway. So it's, you know, it's not, it's an environment where there's not going to be a lot of secrets anyway. There's going to be a lot of talking and swapping of information to begin with. So I pretty much conclude I am infamous. I have gone to enough classes where people say, oh, yes, you practiced there. I remember you, blah, blah, blah. So I concluded that some time ago. I think I talked about that as a black person, victim of racism. You are under surveillance, substantially more so than we know. So no secrets. So I fill out all the information. That was last week. About a week goes by. And I think I said I'd probably come back and be like, oh, nope. Be like, oh no, we heard about you. Get the hell out of here and take that shirt with you. So came back this week, and she says, we're going through, you know, the references and the background and all that. We have to call the courts, and it can take a while to do all those checking, to all that checking. Now, at one level, I totally get it. You know, this is Bill Cosby era. Jerry Epstein, R. Kelly, I get it. You know, you don't want to have a pedophile in the yoga class groping on people, or murderer, or whatever it is. Can't be hiring Bill Cosby to teach the yoga class. On the other hand, you know, yoga instructors aren't really paid that well. That's kind of infamous throughout the industry. You're not teaching children, generally speaking. I haven't seen any children at this studio. You're not teaching children, that sort of thing. We're not working at the United States Department of Treasury. I mean, we're not getting the security clearance to do an hour of yoga teaching. Anywho, so then she's talking, because I feel like, wow, it's my work experience to go through that and see, oh, he's been a freelance journalist. Like, what's that all about? And then for 10 years, so being asked about that and say, yep, we'll have to go ahead and same way Mr. Fuller, we'll just have to say, because I've said it so many times in so many studios, I've worn the shirt, no secrets in the system of racism. So say, oh yeah, I've done this podcast, where I don't say context of white supremacy, I say the cows. The cows. Cows, interesting. Okay, so she pulls out her phone, is going to try to find the episode on iTunes. I'll pause there, just because there are so many aspects of white supremacy, racism, and or workplace racism specifically within this. Pause right here. Before this even happened, I'm doing my internship. I'm at the desk earlier this week. You're supposed to get familiar with the software that they use at a lot of the yoga studios, checking people in, all that. And customer service, so you can say, yeah, you've done all that. You've worked at a studio and checked people in, blah, 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 and the paperwork, waivers, blah, blah, blah. So I'm sitting there doing my intern. White female yoga instructor comes by. I've taken her class. I've seen her, we'll say, three times in life, maybe four, less than five times in life. So she comes by, hey, how's it going? Yeah, it's hanging out. And so other people are coming by. It's not like it's just us two in the room at the desk. And she says, tell me the juiciest thing in your life right now. Now I think, wow, that's quite an invasive question. And so I take a moment. That's something that I encourage on a regular basis in the workplace. Do not feel pressured to respond immediately, particularly if you are asked a question, someone is soliciting a response from you, feel free to, and that might not mean just, I need, 30 seconds to think. That might mean, I have to get back to you tomorrow. If it's Friday, well, I have to get back to you on Monday, and I'm glad it's Monday because I'm going to need about 3 days to think about that, and then we can resume the discussion. That is totally acceptable. I do not take 3 days. I took, some seconds to pause. And I said, first I said, I don't have a very juicy life, which is one thing I would encourage. We are not there to impress people. I wouldn't care if you're going to Tibet this weekend and Mongolia the week after that, and you have a scuba diving trip planned for the end of the year. I would say you have the most mundane, boring life ever. You are not there to share every detail about your life. A lot of these folks are total strangers in the workplace. That doesn't mean that you have to be hostile. Same thing I said before. It's not like you have to be hostile. I'm not saying that you have to be mum, but I certainly would have already established boundary about what you're willing to share and what you're not. And I've particularly talked about, and I think we have talked about the pattern of having white people come and be really invasive and asking you a lot of questions about yourself when it's not reciprocated or even needed for the job. I mean, if it's just chatting about things, we could do that if it's something work-related. But I mean, if it's just coming to dig up and see how much information and data I can get on you, data mining, like, come on. What do I recommend on the program all the time when they come with those type of invasive questions? You want to get things back to the job. I respond to her question, the juiciest part of my life, hoping that people say nice things about me for my job references. And waiting to see if I can get my application through. I think that's pretty juicy, hoping that people will have something cool to say about me. She says, oh, okay, that counts. And then I also add, do not just stand there and be peppered with question after question after question. If it's a dialogue, you should be able to ask questions to stop, because sometimes they'll just get on a roll. I've had that happen to me. We've had other people who've talked about that. Well, it'll just be 15, 20 questions about all kinds of things. Nothing related to the job. Go ahead and ask your own question, which is exactly what I did, and asked a workplace related question. That's what we should be talking about, not just random things and trying to get, into gossip and rumors about your life. Be on guard about that. I encourage that on a regular basis. Be mindful. We've talked about that for a while. That happened before we got to, so what's this podcast? So, what is this podcast you do? The cows. Oh, okay. Wow, you've been doing this for 10 years. That's amazing. And so she's talking about her own thoughts on racism, and why she wanted to have an inclusive studio, used the word inclusive specifically. She talked about having non-white people in her family and seeing how they were in settings, yoga settings specifically, where they were the only non-white person present, and how that had an impact on her and how she wanted to operate the studio and getting away from some of the exclusivity in yoga. I think I mentioned before they have Henrietta Lacks' book. Oh, or it's not Henrietta Lacks' book. I should say it correctly. It's Rebecca Skloot, White Woman, her book on Henrietta Lacks. They had that book in the library at the yoga studio. And so since we're talking about all this, I ask her, I say, so why is that book in a yoga library? Like, it seems so unrelated. And she says, I wanted to include Black people. I wanted to include non-white people in the library, and I could not find yoga books written by Black people. And she said, and I wanted to include them, and, you know, how they often have been treated. And she talked about that book and how much she enjoyed it. And she said, I think it's important. That's why I put that book there. I couldn't find something else. And then she says, Michelle Cassandra Johnson. That's her name. Michelle Cassandra Johnson. This is a Black female. And she has written a book about, she's also a yoga instructor. She's written a book about her experience with yoga and racism. And she does talk. She teaches yoga and then she does talks. I think she lives in Oregon, if I'm not mistaken. She resides in Oregon and she comes to the Washington area, probably other locales as well, to do talks on presumably racism, social justice. The odd thing is that this Black female, Miss Johnson, the white woman yoga instructor who owner, she mentions Miss Johnson no more than I think 30, 45 minutes previously. The same different white woman who mentioned what's the juiciest part of your life. She had just mentioned Miss Johnson's work and saying that I think when I did my response question, what's going on with you? Because I know she's in the 300-hour teacher training. I said, so what did you all learn this week? And she said that they did a section and it included Miss Johnson's work. And she said that it was really tough and they had this room full of white women. And so we're having to sit with our accountability. She's talking about racism. And so that was really difficult. And then no more than 30 minutes later, bang, the owner comes and mentions this woman as well. And she said, I have her book. It's not here. I think she said she either took it home or somehow it got moved. She said, I have her book. That would be a good one to have. And she said, I'll bring it in. You should check it out. So I'm looking online to read this woman's book. Now, at this point, I think I'd already pulled up the cows on the phone. And she's like, all right, I'll take a listen to an episode. Already thinking, oh, well, not going to get this. Not going to get this job and probably will be booted from the studio sometime soon. Who knows which broadcast she'll hear. And so I do think, well, we did do a program on yoga and racism. I will send her that one. That's live and direct to the topic at hand. And I say we had, you know, a guest come on. We talked about yoga and racism. She said, let's hear it. I would love to check it out. I sent her the one with Satya X. If folks recall, that was spring of 2018. I had just started doing yoga. I wasn't even a certified instructor at the time. I'd only been practicing maybe 3 months at the time, 2-3 months. So I send her this program and I say, you know, hey, our program is not intended for whites. And this program in particular is very critical of white women in yoga. And she had just commented on that about white women's role in yoga and making it exclusive and not welcoming for non-white people, sometimes like her family member, non-white family member that I mentioned. So I send all that and I'm still thinking, you know, this is exactly, I tell people all the time, you know, not to talk about white supremacy, racism on the job. It came up directly in this manner, and this seems like it would probably be something common. There are a lot of different yoga studios, I suspect not just here in Washington State, but beyond, where they talk about so-called social justice. They'll talk about racism. I've been to, that's how Anna Brown Griswold, that's how I found out about her. They had her come to do a workshop at a studio, and then they brought her to a different workshop, and they have lots of people who come in and talk about racism, and they'll do a few poses or meditate and charge people $200 to do this. Very, very popular. It's like the Jane Elliott, Tim Wise niche of saying that you are about working against racism in yoga and another way that you can charge a lot of money and still not solve the problem. Very, very popular. So I'd heard about Michelle Cassandra Johnson, this black female. I'd heard about her. I've not heard any of her workshops, but I do know she is. She seems to be pretty popular. I've been to studios where they have invited her as well. So I'm thinking, you know, probably not going to go well, but I'll send it to her. We'll see what happens if she listens to that or listens to any other episode. She could be listening to this episode right now. Either we have a system of racism, white supremacy, or we do not. Anywho, I share all of that to say counter racism, that type of thing might happen. I think we had some other folks who said that they felt their employer might be listening in on a job. There might be a time where racism, white supremacy comes up and comes up in a way where they're sharing that they know you are more informed, that you are less confused. That might happen. I would say try not to be too surprised there either in figuring out how you want to proceed. I guess this would apply more to people if you are more public, perhaps, in addressing racism, white supremacy. If you have aspirations of, I don't know, doing a vlog, a documentary, writing a book, writing an essay, a paper, anything. If you have any aspirations or thoughts of being more public, already have that in mind. And as I said, there are examples. There are people. Mr. Fuller was one who worked a federal government job, no less. It was pretty, you know, public. He wasn't trying to hide his views on white supremacy, racism. I think Dr. Muhammad, he has a YouTube channel, SendQ. He's been a guest on this program repeatedly. Same thing. He said he was on a job. White employer called him in and wanted to ask about his YouTube channel, where he talks very directly about white supremacy, racism. And I think he's even read from Mr. Fuller's section on counter violence. He said they talked about it and moved forward. No problems. He didn't get fired. Continued right on working. So there are examples. I think retired firefighter as well. I think there are a number of examples of victims of racism, black people specifically, who have been very outspoken with their views on white supremacy, racism, while working for and or with individuals classified as white. So there are examples of that happening. Gus T might not qualify as one. As I said, I would pretty much expect there to be, oh yeah, that is, you know, way too controversial, radical, whatever the terminology might be, to have you working here and disrupting folks. Yeah. Get the hell out of here, like I said before. That's pretty much what I would expect, but I will definitely update as to, you know, what happens, how this goes. And clown all the way. Since she mentioned, since they both, the white studio owner and the different white yoga instructor, since they mentioned Miss Johnson and her book, and the white female instructor said she would bring me her book so that I could check it out and read it, I emailed Miss Johnson. I told her the truth. Fall on the truth as frequently as you can. That's something that I try to use as code. If I waver a little bit or get confused, the system of white supremacy is primarily founded on deception. Fall on just being accurate. If I make, you know, I'm a little uncertain about how to proceed. So I'm, you know, accurate. I got this internship, and the white studio owners raved about your work, and even another instructor there as well. And in addition to doing this internship, being a yoga instructor, I do this podcast all about racism. Love talking to other black people to hear about their experience as a yogi and your views or thoughts on using yoga to help solve this problem. She was agreeable to coming to chat on the program. I can now even go in and tell the white yoga instructor, oh yeah, Miss Johnson will be coming to hang out on the podcast. I thought that would be awesome, because then I can say, yep, and you know, either I got hired or didn't get hired and all of the above. I thought that would be grand to have her on the broadcast. Either way, to discuss and show how all of this evolves. So we'll continue to update applying the concepts myself. I certainly would not encourage you all to apply or give you all any suggestions that I would not use myself if I were in your situation. More than anything, I encourage folks to use logic. You be the expert because you have all the information about your situation. Follow logic to solve problems without creating new problems. But certainly, I hope it is a hoot and of some constructive value hearing Gus T apply these counter-racist concepts as we move through the yoga career. I'm supposed to be doing some more teaching next month, and we'll see if that evolves to a job and then how the counter-racist concepts would be applied in that manner, or if it gets snafu'd before we even get to there. Updates are coming, and you can check out, I can post information if you all want to check out Ms. Johnson's website, book, all of the above, to see more of her work. She's a black female in Oregon, as I said, and she should be on the program sometime within the next couple of weeks. Anywho, I think with that, I'll just end with, I don't know if other folks have that experience, but that was a profound one for me, because I do know that my time working with the cows, that there are many folks who are absolutely disgusted with the cows for a variety of reasons, that we had Justice on the program when she was 10, that we have the audacity to invite white people on the program at all, that we have the audacity to invite individuals classified as white on the program and then question them with suspicion. The fact that we are not fans of Jane Elliott, Tim Wise, lots and lots and lots and lots of reasons why folks despise the cows and or Gus T or all of the above. The late Dick Gregory was certainly no fan. So I certainly thought of that quite a bit. Like, wow, I am not sure. Like, they have just that alone, like a list of references. What if they had stumbled and called Dick Gregory? Like, do you think we should hire this Gus fellow? Like, oh my God, like, I'm not going to get the job. Like, I think a lot of black people can relate to that in the system of white supremacy. Like, I think we are in a system that is so, it is so common. It's so cliche. It is so routine. President Obama, to disparage black people, any black person for any reason, that I can certainly relate to folks having consternation. Like, wow, I hope they will have good things to say about me. Context of White Supremacy, Neutralizing Workplace Racism. Number again is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-POUND. Press *61 if you would like to participate. If you have your own situation to address, feel for. Oh, wait a minute. Before I get the callers, make sure I do not let the emails get backed up. First person that wrote in last week, we had a black male dial in. The situation was black supervisor or non-white supervisor. Non-white employee had worked hours for overtime, but he did not get the overtime compensation. The non-white supervisor gave whatever justification for not giving the overtime pay. A person that called in said, well, you know, I guess have a relationship with both of these people. What do I do? Should I try to intervene to help out? That sort of thing. And so we were talking about the best way to try to proceed. We had a person who wrote in and said they would recommend to speak to HR about the matter, that there was a discrepancy with overtime pay, and to do nothing more. I said I generally do not like being involved in situations involving other individuals on the job. You don't have all the information. A lot of times that can produce new problems when now somebody gets upset at you and that sort of thing. Like, you know, if there's information that you can share to help the person solve the problem on their own, great. But having to go in and negotiate and that sort of thing, like, I just have seen where that can be difficult and does not help solve the problem. But this person just recommended going to HR. Leave it at that. UntilJustice@gmail.com. If you have other emails that you would like to send, we can share on the program. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. *61 if you would like to join us. If you have any experience with the LGBTQ seminars or anything, the pronouns in the workplace, that would definitely be good to hear about. The references, folks have thoughts on that. If you have your own situation, certainly if you have figured out some things that work well to solve some of these problems, that is always appreciated. We need more of that. Folks who dialed in with a hand up, line should be open. Feel free to proceed.
Can I be heard?
Greetings, Draftomania.
Greetings, Gus, and callers and listeners. I just wanted to give you guys an update in regards to what I shared about going for the interview for the position. I got the position. I got called today and offered the position, and I accepted. So I just wanted to share that. Good news. And also, I wanted to just talk about something that had happened at the job where one of my coworkers basically was dating me to react to a situation that happened and regarding me supposedly not doing something in a correct manner. And the way that they did it was they kind of had it, it was basically like a baiting situation just to see if I would react in a non-professional manner. Told me that somebody said that I didn't do something correctly, and that she said that she was going to tell that I wasn't supposed to let these people in the door, and he had like other people there as witness. You know, he did it in front of people, and he basically put on like this act in a show as to be upset, and like he made it seem as if he was going to go tell the supervisor the next day that you know, he didn't like the girl's attitude or whatever. And as he was putting on this performance, and this is not the first time I've called to you know, talk about this individual and his theatrics. And during this whole time, as he was, you know, putting on his whole show, you know, in front of the, you know, the rest of the people that were basically kind of, you know, basically in on the situation, his little theatrics, I was very calm. I did not react. Only thing I said to him is that, I didn't know. I said, well, he said, well, you know, well, she didn't know what she, you know, that you, she was supposed to do this, and that something to that effect. So I said, well, basically, I didn't do anything wrong, you know. And the only thing I did is I did what I thought was the next best thing. Thank God I didn't, I didn't let that person, you know, I didn't let the person in the area that they wanted me to let them into. I called the wrong individuals, but I didn't know. But at least I did listen to my instincts. I'm noticing that, and through just basically doing research and learning more that, and learning about like a lot of these, different tactics that, manipulators, use, to basically, get you trapped up into reacting, because, these people get a kick out of just seeing the reaction and this, the drama and things like that. And, I'm learning to just stay calm and not give these people what they want. Usually, in the past, I would be like I've talked about many a times on this program, I would be panicky. And, because you're, you know, that dopamine and adrenaline, you know, it would be like a fight or flight reaction, you know, and I would just react. So I'm learning how to just calm my breathing down, just slow down and think as and just respond as opposed to react. And I know that when you're just reacting out of anger or out of fear, you cannot think. And scientifically, it's proven that you cannot think clearly. So when you just take the time out to just stop and think and slow down, and no matter what's going on, however, you know, whatever individuals are doing around you, even if they are overreacting, if you can just learn how, and I'm going to keep it on me, if I can just learn how to just, you know, slow down, not react, breathe, listen, just stay calm, I come out of the situation a whole lot better. So I was happy about that. I was happy that I came out of that situation well. And what I did is I went to the supervisor, the CEO, or not the CEO, the director of that department, as opposed to listening to the he said, she said, and I went to that individual, and I humbled myself, said, oh, yeah, I do apologize. I'm sorry that I did that. Next time at least next time I know what it is, the proper protocol is, that I'm gonna, whatever I'm supposed to do. And, basically what it was like a triangulation. This person, these people were trying to triangulate me into an argument or into an issue with this other person. So, that's basically what this coworker was doing. But I went to the, supervisor or the manager, and I said to them, I did apologize, and I admitted to what was perceived to be the wrong action, and they told me no problem. I didn't see it as a problem, and it was just squashed just like that. But this person was making it into a big deal when it really wasn't a big deal. Like I said, it was basically a triangulation tactic. But I am happy that I did get the position, and I just wanted to share that with you guys, and thanks for allowing me to share.
Congratulations on getting the position. Very happy to hear it. Hope you get a big raise that comes along with that, and maybe an extra week of paid vacation. In terms of being baited, that's why, you know, for years I've said on this broadcast that the most important aspect of counter-racism for the workplace, us maintaining our composure. I think generally speaking, I always have it in the, wow, it is thundering and lightning here. That is crazy. I guess so. If the power or anything goes out, that is what happened. Thunderstorm here. We don't even have thunderstorms like that. That's the second time that's happened. Wow, totally disrupted my conversation. Congratulations on the job. The baiting thing happens. That's why I say keeping your composure, even in a thunderstorm, is the most important component of counter-racism for the workplace. Because if you that sort of thing happens all the time. That's why you have a website like Chimp Out, because racists do things on a regular basis just to try to get us to respond emotionally so that they can fire us or whatever. Or sometimes just that's the racist joke for the day. Let me get on this nigga's nerves for 5 minutes and see them get stressed and upset, and then I'm good. I can go back to my desk and get a little work done until my next smoke break. Like that, you know, sometimes that's what it is. So the best way to extinguish that, breathing, just monitoring when they're saying these type of things, I'm going to tell on you. And that's so juvenile. And my counter-racist response, if you're in a work environment, I wouldn't care if this is a white person or a non-white person. I think this is a non-white person who, unless I'm mistaken, but I wouldn't care who says that in a workplace context. I'm going to tell on you because you did this. I might go and call the person that they're going to, quote unquote, tell on me to. Call them right now and let them know what you did. Because I think the vast majority of times, most of us in our workplace, we are doing the correct thing. frequently we don't get trained properly. So it might be that we did make an error, just not knowing, or if they had a change in procedure or what have you. But I mean, if that's what it is, oh yeah, let's call them right now. I did such and such and such and such. Is that the proper protocol? No, it's okay. Well, if there's any additional training, I would love to volunteer to sign up for that so that I can make sure to be more efficient in the future, make sure that there's nothing that I've missed so that I can do my job to the best of my abilities. And I'll make sure, you know, to make a notification and I'll do that in the future. Thank you for clearing up any problems. Thanks so much. And if it is in violation of policy and procedure, if this is something that I've been doing for a long time, why hasn't this been pointed out before? Like, that's due process, too. Mr. Fuller talks about that. Why not point that out in the spirit of, oh, this is, you know, an error that you've made. This is the correct way so that you can move forward. You can be doing it in a great way. We're all helping the company out. Why not be corrective so that I can enhance, nourish my value to the company? As opposed to we're going to be
negative. Yeah, and I did, like you said, I did exactly what you just said. I said, I went to that, to the, supervisor, the manager, and I, you know, I admitted, you know, I stated what I did, but he heard it, over the, microphone anyway. And what, like I said, it was basically like this person was trying to make it seem like somebody else was saying something. It was like a he said, she said, a gossiping thing, a triangulation. Like I said, somebody was supposed to have gotten upset. He wanted to make sure he came to me. But like I said, I just didn't trust any of it. And I just made sure I went to the direct party, to the man, the manager, and I made sure I straightened it out with him. And it wasn't even a big deal. Like you said, if there was any type of issues, if there's a problem, just go and admit. I mean, if you do something wrong, admit that you did, that you were wrong at something. And like you said, a lot of times it's not even that you're doing anything wrong. It's just that these other people are just trying to get you to, as you said, chimp out, because they just want to see you overreact so they can make you look like a fool. So, you know, like, I'm just learning. Like I said, I'm still learning. These are things I wish I would have known a long time ago, but it's okay, because I'm, you know, it's never too late, you know, because as long as you got life in you, you're going to have to keep going through experiences. So, better late than never. So that's all I have to say. And thank you, again for, the congrats, and I hope, everything works out in your, for the best interest of you also, Gus.
Much obliged. I will update, let us know how the upgrade in employment goes and all of that. I'd be looking out for new training opportunities there, but that's so important, for non-white people, regardless of what your, career, what your field is, just being mindful of that, that there probably will be some individuals, sometimes even non-white people, where that's what they are attempting to do to get you to respond. I think we had the caller down at the courthouse in Florida. The white woman, she was wearing the same clothes every day, trying to get people to respond. Be mindful of that in the workplace. That's why I said sometimes be careful. Don't feel like you got to be pressured to respond right now. Even if you want to say something immediately, sometimes it's best. Let me think a little bit before I, you know, reveal, you know, a thought or observation or whatever. On a situation, let me remain silent until I've thought of the best possible response. Again, solving problems without creating new problems. Context of white supremacy. Much obliged, Straptomania. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Next person wrote in. Let's see. Oh, I messed up the switchboard. Anyway, next person that wrote in, they said, by 2020, some 80% of businesses will be monitoring employees using a range of tools and data sources. Oh, they shared a report. This is from USA Today. The report reads, don't look now. Your boss is probably spying on your work phone or computer. Like Facebook and Google, your employer may be the next to spy on and track you. If you're concerned about being tracked by Facebook and Google when you're out and about by stores, when you enter their retail environment, get used to it. Because at work, your employer is probably doing it now and will be even more active very soon. This is the modern workplace now, says Brian Kropp, a group vice president with business consultancy Gartner. If you work at a medium to large sized company, the odds are the different behaviors you engage in will be tracked by your employer, generated and collected by someone in the organization. By 2020, some 80% of businesses will be monitoring employees. That's like in a couple months. Using a range of tools and data sources, according to Gartner. This is up from 50% currently and just 30% in 2015. Gartner surveyed 239 large corporations to come up with its conclusions. If you work on a company-issued computer or phone and access the firm's network, they can get access, says Kropp. I would think perhaps if you're not even on a company-issued computer, if you're on your own computer, but you get on the company's network, they might be able to get access to your information that way as well. I would be concerned enough that I would probably be hesitant to get on their network with my own device even. Anyway, when the subject is broached with people, they tend to get defensive and worry about Big Brother, says Kropp, until he explains why the companies are doing this. I'm not going to read the whole article. They go on to try to explain, but wow. Be mindful. I think I've said for years, we're under surveillance in the workplace. Just be mindful of that. I said I read the policy and procedure when I was going over and going through the application, and it says, yes, we can review websites and what have you on the company computer. You should expect that. I think that's standard operating procedure 2020 and moving forward. You should be thinking that and be mindful of what sites you're looking at, what websites you go to, what you're doing on the computer, period, while you're there. In my opinion, it's not my machine, not my desk, not my network. Very important to keep that in mind while we are in the workspace. Let's see. Get one more in. All right. Different. Caller wrote in, black female. My question to all is, has anyone had trouble or had their reviews rejected from Glassdoor or indeed from mentioning racism or sexual harassment? I think someone just mentioned that. Whenever I mention those two things, my reviews never get posted or they get immediately deleted. At my job, I overheard a white male and a non-white, non-black female make an offensive joke. Ooh, what's the joke? The white male had mentioned he wanted to see a cockfight, which is a chicken fight. The non-black, non-white female starts laughing and says that it's illegal. So the white male employee says, see, that's why there are so many shootings. Would you rather see a dead cock or a dead body? That joke didn't make sense to me, but it had all the white supremacist elements in it. The white male says a lot of refined, undercover, racist things to this non-black, non-white female, but she just thinks these are just jokes because he's a good guy. The white male will actually get up from his desk just to go text racist things to his friends who do not work here. It's pretty obvious because he will tell the joke to the non-white female, and she will start laughing. That is Gavin De Becker, The Gift of Fear, talking about violent acts in the workplace. Bing, I would write that down right there and ask now, does this promote a safe, that's my $5,000 word. That's way too cheap for 2020. But I mean, safety, get that in as frequently as possible. If that's something that you wanted to bring up. I overheard this in the workplace. Is this sort of conversation, is this sort of subject matter? Does this promote a safe work environment where we feel welcome, included, able to sit down and do our work without distraction, where we're talking about dead cocks and chicken fighting in 2020? you could bring that up and you don't even have to address racism, white supremacy at all. But I think that's what Gavin, that's one at least I remember from Gavin DeBecker, where he said people making those types of remarks, talking about that sort of subject matter in the workplace is, boop, that is a red flag right there. Inappropriate, not promoting workplace safety. With the rest of it, yes, mentioning racism, yes, I can certainly relate to that being something that seems like it might jeopardize your career or at least stymie your development. I don't know how it's if it's being mentioned within your actual review, like in the body of your work, you're talking about racism and that's causing the problem, or if it's something something else. But I can certainly relate to that being a problem in the workplace. That's one of the reasons why I encourage not discussing racism, white supremacy in the workplace, although that certainly becomes more challenging if you are in a work environment where racism is already being discussed. Let's see. Non-white people participating in this sort of thing in the workplace. And it should not be a surprise. You got lots of victims of white supremacy all over the world. Confusion is lethal. It could have been me participating in that type of thing in the workplace when I was more confused about white supremacy, racism. So not being surprised and not taking it out on those victims. That's what I mean about having a code. I think it's important just recognizing they're a victim of racism. I'm going to be mindful when I'm around them, having seen this, to make sure that I'm just talking. I'm not being reckless and talking about anything, saying anything about white people and or even other non-white people. I'm not going to be talking to them about my views on racism or trying to get them to get Mr. Fuller's book, Victim of Racism. I'll be courteous to them, but hey, that's why I say United Independent can't be having expectations that this victim might be confused and might do some snitching, might do some anti-black things to be harmful to you. So victim, United Independent, trying to keep myself safe first and foremost, taking that information about my environment. Let's see. I'll stop there. Other folks, dial in if y'all have your own situation. If we have any folks, any experience with the so-called LGBTQ and pronoun changes in the workplace, that would be good. If we have any folks, if you have or having any problems in the workplace, certainly you can speak to that. If we have any folks who have figured out some things that work well to minimize problems without creating new problems, that is always grand, I guess. And if any folks, the trepidation of wondering in a system of white supremacy, do you have enough folks? Do you have folks who have good things to say about you? Good enough things that it will qualify for a job reference? That is welcome as well. Other folks with a hand up, proceed.
Hi, Gus.
Greetings, B in Toronto.
Greetings to you, callers and listeners. I'd have to say that this week has been a particularly trying week. It's to be expected, though. The same group of white females who have been targeting myself has been expanding their operation, making sure to spread their poison to other departments. What has been happening as of recent is there has been at least a couple of job openings that were available. And what was really interesting is although I have been interviewed for both, the two areas that are outside of the department that I'm in, they've quickly expanded their poison to those very areas that I would like to get into. I had ensured through request to my supervisor to not inform any members on my team as to whether I've gone for an interview, and if so, to which departments, because I was concerned. as to this very thing happening, and nonetheless, it occurred. I think the reason why is that there was a custodian that's also part of their team that had seen me in one of the interview rooms and has, you know, sent word of me being there. And I guess it's disturbed the hornet's nest on their part, because they've definitely ramped up spreading more false allegations and just making it as difficult to be there as possible. So I've already made a decision of working on my 6-month exit plan from that particular plantation. So I've already made that decision. What I would recommend to those who are going through something similar is learning the powerful technique of acceptance of the situation, looking at the situation for what it is. I think too many of us, and I'm also very much included in this, would like to have that hope that things will get better. Unfortunately, with white supremacists and suspected white supremacists, they will continue. There is absolutely no redeemable qualities among them. They will continue to terrorize relentlessly. And I find that once I accept the situation for what it was, it helps me gain more understanding, and it helped me gain more strength in even more so standing up against white supremacy. I hope it doesn't sound too coded, but I really found that by actually accepting the situation, not meaning that I like it, but seeing for what it was, it helped me to determine what directions that I wish to take. In terms of finding enough people to vouch on your behalf, I know that the very first time that I connected with the show, one of the things that I had recommended was what was known as a show me binder, where it outlines what you've done in terms of productivity and how that has contributed to your success, written recommendations, any articles that or recommendations, awards, things of that nature. Because it can be quite difficult enlisting friends to fill in the references as well helps. Also, if you are volunteering, that also helps as well. But also, again, being mindful as to whom you are asking to do the references on your behalf, because I have come across situations where I have, and this has only happened when it has come to light. I haven't had this happen to anyone else, really. But when I've asked references from whites, they would say yes, they would provide the reference. And then as it nears the time for them to provide the reference, either they're not available to provide that reference, or they've may have said something to sabotage that opportunity. So again, be very aware of the type of person that you're asking to do the reference on your behalf, because majority of the time they do not come through. And thanks so much. I'll leave the line.
Much obliged. Be in Toronto. Very, very important pattern to, excuse me, very important pattern to observe about when it's time for the reference to actually come through, it not being delivered and the stress that can go with it. I think also the earlier portion when you were talking about your current work situation and applying for a different job and people that have racists that have already been hostile towards you, where you were hoping that they would not, this would not become office rumor and what they're going to be discussing, if we could be discreet about me applying. And then this, you know, ends up the other people will get to it. And as you said, they ratchet up their attack on you. Standard operating procedure. And that's why I just read the report that the listener shared about the surveillance. You have all of that, and then that might even just be some unjust networking. Like, oh, you know this nigger? She applied for a job over here like she's trying to get away from us? Well, let's make sure we spread a few extra rumors this week, make sure she doesn't get it. I absolutely think that that sort of thing happens. We've heard enough black people. That's cliche, black people not being promoted on jobs. Calvin Lawrence talked about that exactly when he was on the program with the Royal Mounted Canadian Police, no less. Not McDonald's or something, what have you. But he talked about that exact same thing, trying to get out and specifically trying to get away from a hostile, racist work situation to get to a different environment. And that being sabotaged by people saying, oh, no, we don't want that no good Calvin around here talking about racism. Let's sabotage that. We'll spread some more rumors about him. Standard, not to be surprised on either front, them trying to sabotage potentially you getting this different position and there not being any privacy about you. That's why I said context of white supremacy. Sometimes you just got to, you know. That's just what it is. No secrets. And we just, you know, deal with things as best you can. But yeah, I hope if it will be a benefit and a huge boost in salary and a great stepping source to you getting a whole better occupation job together, hopefully you'll get the position and be able to get some major distance from these race soldiers that have been causing so much havoc on the job for you. Let's see. Much obliged for sharing. Be in Toronto. I think it's also important being honest with yourself. That's why I said being honest with yourself about what you're dealing with. Very important. Very, very important with the hostile situation that we're in. You can't lie. Accepting things as they are and then trying as best we can to use logic to solve problems with the reality we face that can be very discouraging at times. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to chime in. Let's see.
Hi, Gus.
Yes,
sorry, it's me in Toronto once again. The call had dropped, and I've called back in right away. It's becoming a pattern as of late. But I just wanted to add a couple of things real quickly, if that's okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. The other thing I had noticed, and this is quite similar to the interview that was had with the young man who did the book on Black Cop in working in Canada as such, is the way that I experienced it is you are targeted for doing the job that you're hired to do. So basically, you're being targeted for existing, but then it gets even worse. The terrorism gets even worse when you're following the rules and doing what you're supposed to do. It's as if you have no rights to say move your chair, even though everybody in that office space has a right to move their chair to another seat if they wish to, or it's you have no rights to apply for a job. And these things are all unspoken. They're like unspoken rules. You have no right to apply for another job. It's as if, how dare you possibly think, you know, to possibly apply. Mind you, I'm working in an environment that's about, I've only literally seen about 5 or 6 people. The majority are white. You might get at least 10 Asians, maybe 9 or 8 Indians from India, but the majority are white. And one of the places that I applied to, they have no black people on their team. And at first it was cordial. It appeared as cordial. But as soon as word spread that I had applied, and mind you, I'm wanting to keep this private, but as soon as word spread that I've applied to their team, you know, they've definitely, by their behavior, made it clear they want no niggers on their team. You know, and then it has that uppity, you know, who's this uppity black female? How dare they possibly feel that they can, you know, do what they're, how dare they feel that they're, you know, like anybody else? And with the unjust networking, they'll even use their schedules, because I've noticed that they have the schedule with meeting lunch for with another terrorist that used to work there. And I'm the only person that has not been asked. I've been excluded out of that. I made sure that I kept a copy of it to show as proof of alienation. Not that I would have gone to lunch with them anyways, because I value my life a lot more. I don't want it to be around that toxicity. But yes, I mean, these are the things that happen. I've come to that acceptance that no matter what you do, these people just despise you for existing. These whites just despise you for existing. And at this point in my life, it's, you know, I'm going to keep fighting against this. That's what I've resolved through the acceptance of the situation. Thank you. And again, I'll leave the line.
Thank you for pointing out the problems with being able to call in. I think you had pointed that out before. I think for a time I was trying to call you on my line to get you on because you were having such difficulties, and other folks reported that as well. So the interference is not just in the workplace, but that is another huge pattern that we have observed. When you said, you know, the thunder, where you said it's as though you don't have the right. How do you have the audacity to apply for another job? You know, who does this nigger think she is? That's the environment. That's not just Toronto. That's not just Canada. That is the entire known universe. And that's so important, because I think that surprises many black people. They think if I go in and work hard and show some enthusiasm and some ambition, that I will be treated well, and they'll think that I'm not like the rest of the black people, and I'll move on up the ladder. And frequently that is not the case at all. Mr. Lawrence talked about that as well, thinking that, you know, hey, if I'm just an ambitious enforcement official, I'm working for the mounted police up here in Canada, and if I just show them that I'm dedicated and just want to be a great cop, no, you are mistaken. that just enraged them more. Who is this uppity nigger? Exactly. Who is this uppity nigger? What is he doing here? That is the system of racism, white supremacy, unfortunately. Confuses many, many non-white people worldwide. Wow, the thunder is aggressive. Confuses many, many non-white people worldwide. That is why we have workplace racism. Other folks, if you have suggestions, questions, comments, number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943. pound. Press star 61 if you would like to join in.
May I be heard?
Greetings, caller in Florida.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners and callers. My first two reports I want to share have something to do with the security again. So actual race soldiers in uniform. Well, one is apparently a white man that they call the sergeant. And I noticed they've been alternating the sergeants out. So this guy, he already mentioned something about me tampering or breaking the doorknob, and they tried to regard it as a joke. They reduced it as to it being about a joke. So I think they addressed this guy because he had started becoming very nervous around me. And now I want to look me in the eye. Okay, so on Monday, I just knew it was something racist. I knew he was going to practice racism. Sometimes you just get a sense of predicting them. So he was walking away from one of the officers, and he says, all right, you know, I'm going to head on to the bathroom or something. I'm going to head on down the hallway. He says, oh, you know, watch out. Looks like we have a stranger here. So I said, so are you going to do this again? Really? So are you going to do this again? I asked him twice. So I got on the elevator. He didn't answer my question. He was kind of just giggling or whatever. And then the next time, like, I saw him, his face started turning red, like, man, oh my goodness, like, don't go report me or something like that. And I just kept walking. And he didn't say anything to me, like, all week long. And another officer, he said? Okay, I was another one having to do with elevators. Me and two other black females, the black females walked ahead of me. They got on the elevator. And I was getting on last. And another white man, he says, all right, hurry up. And I saw it was blank, meaning my name. And I think he said I almost wanted to close the door, or if it wasn't me, I would have closed the door. Something that was centered around my name. So I made a confident statement. I said, wow, I'm about to clock in. I'm already under attack. So they were like smiling or whatever. So I mean, like, you could tell, like, oh man. So he was trying to smile, like, very nervously. And the black female was like, oh, it's already starting. So I told him, I said to them, y'all have a good day. And it's something about that work, because he stayed away from me. Okay, like, he every time, like, if he's standing there, he got to look down at his phone or something. Like, I don't know, like, they definitely, I don't know if it was the clerk that said something, or the supervisor, or some authoritative white person got to them or something. Hey, leave this guy alone, man. How many times I got to keep telling y'all? Okay, and it won't even almost let me get back to where I can report it. If I'm just saying, if I'm making these, sometimes I'll make a response, I'll ask a question, or I won't say nothing. And it seemed like it's been working to me. But yeah, I was like, wow, only been here for a few minutes, I'm already under attack. But I wanted to use that word attack on purpose. Like, I really wanted to use that word, because that's an attack. So nobody asked me nothing. Nobody was like, wow, like, why did you use that word? But the black females were like, oh my goodness. So we all just went on about our business. My third one is there was another conversation or incident where the black female that I speak with about workplace racism during break time, she was talking about, she came in a break room and there was a white supervisor down there. And, you know, I was asking, I was like, what happened over the weekend? Because she went to, what was that? Bradford County, you know, down here in Florida. And apparently they was practicing racism at the football game, like, because it was a away game for their school. So her daughter, I think, had so-called white friends or whatever, white people that was in the band with her. And one of the white children said, look at the nigger girl. Now, she didn't tell me that until, you know, I had conversed with her, but I could tell it was something about white supremacy. And the white woman, the coworker, she was like, yeah, you know, I know that they're racist at that school and at other schools and stuff like that. But she said that they had to get a police escort last year when they played that same team. So the white people in the department, they definitely was, they were being quiet. One of them said that, you know, well, I apologize. Well, when I was younger, we had to take a separate bus or something like that. And another white woman was saying that her white child was told that, I guess, he couldn't sit with the other white kids or something about that. But she said that the people there are racist. So she used the word racist. And we had agreed that we don't really try to talk too much about racism. But that was an issue that came up because she had a horrible experience at that school being a visiting team for the football team. My next one is there was one where another elevator situation where the white woman got onto the elevator. And I told you we had a new black male start. So they've been trying to work on me psychologically because I've been reporting them. So I think they're in fear in a sense. So one of them says, oh, you know, I went to high school with such and such, right? The other black male. So I was like, oh, no, I didn't know that. I was like, yeah, you know, I just noticed that he was working here. And then the other white woman, she says, yeah, you know, I thought that was interesting because I saw when you looked at him, I knew you had to know him because you said, hey, how you doing? And you know what? I'm going to call you by your name. Now I'm thinking, what does that mean? So we get off and then, you know, we're going to clock in. And then not too long after that, it's another incident where she is going into where the black female is at, in the office that's been assigned to her. And she hands her a copy of something to record and she walks back out. And, she says something about, oh, well, you know, today is just a good day to piss somebody off. Today is a good day to piss people off or something like that. Once again, a very bold, arrogant statement and saying that in response to a black female. And then the black female just says, well, you're just going to end up making yourself upset. And the other white woman who mistreated a black customer, she doesn't really say it. She tends not to say anything. So she's practicing white code right there. And then the same white woman, she also posted, I found on her public Facebook page, she posted a video about Halloween and she tagged in the people that's in the group chat that people have been suspecting that they have. And it says social justice warriors versus Halloween, and it has a white woman and a judge scene, of course, a courtroom scene, where they have two white people saying that these different costumes that people wear are racist. You have an Asian Black Panther, and the Asian kid is saying, well, they won't let me be Black Panther. And it's a Hispanic girl saying, well, they won't let me be Moana. And the white woman says, oh, well, you know, all you just need to do, just get some spray tan. And a bunch of racist, tacky comments in the video. So I screenshotted that, you know, and I saved it. So as documentation right there, like, they're attacking each other. Of course, unjust networking, definitely. And my last one is another report from the black female. She overheard one of the females from the tagged post say that apparently her daughter got in trouble at school for saying the C word and the N word. Now, she asked me, what is the C word? And I think, Gus, you mentioned the word coon, I think. And I used that word, so she thought about that. She said maybe that could have been a word. But the white woman's daughter, 3 or 4 year old daughter, was using the N word in class. And she was like, she told her, oh, well, you know, we don't use those words. So definitely standard white supremacy being practiced. And that's all I have to share. Thanks for allowing me to speak.
Hold up. It was the white woman's 3-year-old daughter, you said, was using the C word and the N word? Is that the age?
Yes, sir, because I know she is. She, I believe, had that baby back in, it had to be like 2015, 2016, one of them. So she has to be at least 4 by now. Because I asked her, was it the oldest one? Because she has 2. I said, was it the older one or the youngest one? She says, no, it was the older one. She overheard the people talking in the other department.
Man, I said last week, memory is not that bad. Yoga. Woo. I said last week, for folks to share, if you have a code on white people bringing their children into work, because you never know, you know, what they might say, that is important to have a code about that. But I mean, wow, I was not thinking that if a 3-year-old comes in, you might be prepared because they might call you a coon. I was not thinking that in my mind, but I mean, wow, 3 and already that's in. I got the book right here. Two-Faced Racism. Joe Feagin, now he has it at age 5, but it's the same thing. His example, it was a little white 5-year-old went to work and was telling racist jokes and got in trouble. And in this case, the parents did fess up and say, we got to be more careful about telling racist jokes at the dinner table because, you know, Johnny got in trouble. This one, she's going to come and lie and say, oh, my Lord, little June, old four-year-old June, we don't know where she got that from because we don't use that type of language, going around calling people niggers. And then the C word. I said that last week. If you all have a vote for what a C word is. Now, I know for some of the Me Too, it's cunt. I don't think that's what this 4-year-old was saying. If it was coupled with nigger, I will take that wager like big time. Whatever you want to put down, it was coon, not cunt. But I would add like, nobody should. That's why I don't like any of the censoring. That's why I put nigger back in when I play the audio clips. Like if they said nigger, if they said spear chucker, if they said coon, it will not hurt my feelings. Let's just go ahead and, you know, here, because it might not be coon. It might be, who knows? Like, just go ahead and say it. Colored. Let's just go ahead and hear what was said, and then we can move forward. But four. I was going to get the audio segment in. If anyone is ignorant about racism, it is black people. Neely Fuller Jr. is about 90 years old now, and it sounds like this 4-year out there. I don't need Cody to coon move. I got it. Like 4 years old. That is, man.
Let's see. I would have been embarrassed to have to share that. Like, my God, the four-year-old. And then I'm going to have to explain, where did she get this from? She was watching YouTube videos and something came up about coons. We left. She was watching cartoons and came back and she was listening to rape. Like, come on. Come on. Come on. Let's see. I lost my list. The coon thing. I mean, she said it messed. I totally. Okay, here we go. It made me lose my list. The four-year-old is talking about coons. Let's see. The coming in, the elevator insults, Mr. Fuller does normally talk about that, but when he mentions it, it's other non-white people saying rude things to each other on the elevator to go to work. That's the way he describes it. We got something totally different here with the white man maybe saying, hadn't been you, I'd have closed the door, or whatever he said when they, in my view, when those type of things, that's another one, Gavin DeBecker, where he said, trust your intuition. When people make those type of comments and you're not quite sure, you know, what they said, they got it in quick. It sounded like they might have said something slick, trying to be insulting with the door. I would generally say trust your instincts. But we're in an environment where you can't even trust them not to tamper with your water. They don't get the benefit of the doubt. And then, love it. Strategic use of words. The day has just started and I am under attack, which you are. You know, they're threatening to slam the door in your face on the elevator, whatever. Not even allow you to ride up. You got to catch the stairs, nigger, coon. Beautiful, beautiful. And to be able to notice that, like, oh, God, now he's been attacked. Love it. Even when the black female said it started already, I even got a question in there. What started? And ask it innocently, too. What started? The elevator? You press the button? We're going, okay, yeah. We're good? Yeah. And then to end it all, same thing I say consistently, not about being aloof. We didn't come to work to be mute. Mute, morning, afternoon. Did it? I've been attacked. Acknowledge that. We ride up and everyone have a good afternoon. And then you go about your, love it, love it, love it. They will continue to be off guard. Got this niggery. And again, I would notice that as well. If you're in a work environment where you're not going around cursing at people, you're not calling people names and that sort of thing. You do your job. You follow policy and procedure. You ask questions and point out if you're being mistreated and try to stop that. But I would note that if whites are treating you a little bit differently, or acting like, you know, they're apprehensive or being mindful about what they say, because that is irregular. White people generally don't do that. They are, I mean, talk about uppity. Woof. Like, that is super irregular. I would note that if that's how they are treating you in a work environment. Let's see. The incident that came up with the black female reporting what happened at the high school. The nigger girl, they called some black child, a black girl, called her a nigger girl or what have you. And talking about this place having a reputation for being racist. I guess if you... I always feel some type of way, you know, discussing racism in the workplace, even with other non-white people. But you know, you all have a rapport and that sort of thing. So the same thing I say for anybody, you have a rapport with a person and right on, they feel comfortable bringing up that sort of thing and feeling like you are sensitive and someone who can talk about this sort of thing in an honest manner. Great. I still am sent what I just read, the report, USA Today. I'm just going to read the title. Don't look now, but your boss is probably spying on your work phone or computer. That's the sort of thing I'd be thinking about, too, because they said by 2020, again, that's like weeks, right? We could count them down. That's days away. By 2020, 80% of workplaces will be using some sort of recording device. I'd be thinking like, oh, man, maybe we could do this after work. That's what I'd be thinking, like, ooh, this does sound really constructive, and I would like to talk about this, but wow. They got the gang is doing the unjust networking on the social media platform. Like, oh, man, they just something to think about. You know, not saying it's nothing incorrect. I'm just saying, you know, it is almost 2020. I've been saying it's 2020, basically. Like, same thing I said before. If you everything we say in the workplace, you know, be comfortable with everybody in the courthouse, everybody in the company hearing, you know, the whole conversation word for word, bit by bit. Be comfortable with that. If you're not comfortable having that said, having that on the record, then, you know, think twice about that conversation. Let's see. What else would I have there? The white woman who came in and said that she came in, today is a good day to piss people off. Now, we are not at Dunkin' Donuts. We are not at McDonald's. We are at the courthouse, I thought. Like, that's the attitude I would expect. So we're gonna undercook all of the chicken sandwiches today. Like, the folks coming to come in think they get some, they're gonna all be undercooked. We're gonna piss them all off today. Or, you know, we're gonna mess up all the fries. Like, okay, you're upset, whatever. Not gonna put much glaze on the donuts today. We are at the courthouse. I thought they had totally different standards for professionalism, both internally and externally, how we're going to treat the patrons that come in and how we treat our employees at the courthouse. Oh, no, not today is a good day to piss people off. And I even love it. The black female response, you just end up upsetting yourself. Why not be peaceful? Come on. We're at the courthouse here. Like, love. But I mean, just that, that's the type of thing I would write down when I tell people I have a workplace journal. Like, that would be something important. Perhaps 6 months down the road, just to remember, if this person is up for promotion, that's the sort of thing I would mention if I was in position to contribute or anything. Like, this person comes in with an attitude of pissing people off. I thought we were about justice. Does that sound just to be treating fellow coworkers like that? Like, what? And she could be on. Yeah, lots could be said about that. Let's see. The white woman saying that she would call you by name, I thought that one was curious as well. What do you normally call me, or how do you normally reference me, or in your head? I thought that was quite curious. I didn't want to forget either being accused, because I've talked about that. That is so important, being accused. And I think you've mentioned a number of times, you got accused of breaking the door. You mentioned you got accused. Wasn't that the camera too? They had one of the white women broke the camera, and then something happened where they tried to make a joke or something to say you broke the camera too.
I think, well, that one was only on, it was two cameras were replaced from the two females that broke the camera. And you're correct, the one of the higher-ups, a day later, he said, hey, you know what? You're the only one that hasn't broken the camera yet. So definitely kept me in mind. You guys got to stop being rough with that camera. Y'all, like, incorporating me, like, you all. But I didn't even break the camera.
It just... all of that, I would be mindful, because it seems like it's such a common thing for black people to be accused or incorporated in accusations of incorrect things happening, or something being broken or stolen, any of that. I would be super mindful. I would take all of that seriously. Like, I would want an investigation, retraction, all of that, because it's so common. And those types of things end up being a big deal. They'll end up being a reason given as to why you don't get a raise or a promotion or some kind of nonsense like that, where you have some sort of totally unfounded, untrue accusation, lie, and it ends up, oh yeah, people thinking that it's got some sort of merit, that you actually did this, so you actually broke the door and that sort of thing. And then you have the self-respect to no, I did not break the door. That is serious. We don't want to be those doors can be expensive, thousands of dollars sometimes, to be replaced. I don't want to be making reckless accusations. And then have the audacity, what? He's got some self-respect to stand up for himself. And then I'm going to be nervous about how I deal with this person in the future. Have the black self-respect to speak up for yourself, because that is so, so important. That's one of those things I think of as like a test. Let's see if we can do this one. Get away with that. Let's see if we can do this one. Get away with that. Stop it at the knees. Any sort of accusation. I wouldn't care what it is, that you broke a toothpick. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Let's stop and step back. I don't even touch toothpicks. Let's see if my fingerprints are on it. Like, let's investigate. Take all of them seriously, because so many of them, woo, Bill Cosby, so many of them end up being seriously. Take them all seriously. But the 4-year-old, coon, nigger, and the school, that's white children are not ignorant about white supremacy, racism. I would love to know where that might even be a question that I ask, particularly if this person is talking about it, like, man, June, Margaret, Miss Johnson, may I ask if you have any theory on where your child might have heard coon? And see what she said. Do you think another family member might have said coon in her presence? Do you think someone else in your house might have said coon? A neighbor? Your husband? Really? And just see what she says. Just man, oh man, maybe even nigger too, but coon would have really stood out. Because I mean, wow, that one is, woof. I feel like most of the time I hear victims saying that. But wowee, workplace racism, much obliged, caller in Florida. Always a treasure trough of counter-racist anecdotes and lessons from the courthouse. Other folks who dialed in, if you have a hand up, we've missed you. Line should be open. Proceed.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings, good greetings, all the listeners and callers. Forgive me, I'm kind of nervous. I'm a first time caller and long time listener. I'm sorry. But, all right, I'm 24 years old and I'm obviously a black male and I'm 6'5", and I'd say I have probably the same skin tone as Muhammad Ali had. And I'm just saying that to say I'm currently an engineering student, and I think I have ATD, which is antisocial personality disorder. And basically what that is, it kind of reduces your ability to empathize with people. And I think that has taken an effect on my social skills and what white people call networking, quote unquote. And I don't know, I'm just wanted to get any of the views on any of the other victims, basically some tips on trying to get a corporate office job and just some things to do, basically. And from you, I also just is being codified and trying to get these types of jobs and wild experience in racism. Thank you.
I guess with the antisocial personality, did you get like a diagnosis, or is that just something where you kind of came to a conclusion yourself that you think that's applicable to your situation and how you are responding to folks? Or did someone else give you that diagnosis?
Oh, no. In the state that I'm in, that's a conclusion I came to myself. I couldn't get diagnosed with APD because in the state that I'm in, if you are diagnosed with that, you can't have firearms. And I think that'll put me in a more dangerous state.
Okay. Philando Castillo, they kill a lot of black people, even with firearms, but that notwithstanding, the reason that I asked about the diagnosis, I think, I give pause, when there are labels attached to black people or we attach labels to ourselves, that are less than positive. I'll put it that way. I think in the system of white supremacy, I think there is a collective, grand, wide-scale lack of empathy for, I mean, we wouldn't have a system of white supremacy if we had collective empathy. So that gave me pause. Anyway, if you're looking for like suggestions, I heard you say on getting a corporate job, and maybe that might be difficult while you're experiencing racism. And if you feel like you are not very empathetic towards others, and does that mean that you Are you more reserved, tending to be quieter? Are you thinking that might cause a problem in terms of you being able to get hired in a corporate environment?
Absolutely.
Okay. If I heard correctly, you said you're an engineering student. Is that correct? Yes? No?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm not an engineer. I'm not an engineering expert. But I think that might be one of the fields, because you're going to be spending some time at a desk with a computer in there, if not a good bit of time doing that at some point, that you don't have to be the most outgoing social person, because you are going to be doing some computer work, unless I'm, you know, totally in error. But I don't think you have to totally change your personality. I think I've said several times just today, if you know you want to be in that environment, I would already just craft. It's about what you're going to say and figuring out, you know, ways that you can participate in a dialogue so that you can rebuff to some degree. I mean, you don't have to necessarily win the Mr. Congeniality Award, right? But I can participate in a codified manner in asking questions, answering questions, so people do hear me talk, presenting my ideas, most importantly, and presenting information about the job that we're trying to get done. Absolutely, so that you're doing all that, that becomes a part of the conversation, just not engaging in a lot of frivolous conversation. And we've had people say, just, hey, let it be known, I am a quiet person. I'm about getting the job done and getting it done in a competent, efficient manner. And sometimes that involves saying less, doing more hard work. You can explain it just that way. Who's going to be upset about that if you're doing quality work? So if I would say the environments that you're looking to be in, if you can get opportunities to talk to people that are already in that environment, if you can get opportunities to visit that environment in some way, shape, form, if you can get, even if it's part-time work, I don't know if they're internships, where you can kind of see what that environment will look like, so you'll already know how much dialogue is going to be required, what types of situations, how much chatting am I going to have to be engaged in, that sort of thing. If we have any folks who are in the engineering field, I know we do. That's somebody's handle, Black Engineer. If we have any of our engineering folks that are here, if you know, kind of want to speak to how much chit chat you have to be engaged in for your particular field, I know they have different types of engineering. So if you want to share how much, I guess, office banter is a part of your profession, that would be grand. But if you, I mean, you called in here and you were fine. You talk to us, we're strangers, and this is, you know, being recorded live. Like, it would be substantially lower stakes just talking to like one individual classified as white in a, you know, non-radio setting in an office. Like, that should be easier. And then you would have specific things, like you could be talking about projects or things that are happening in the office, or a raise, what are vacation policy. I mean, you know, it's lots of things right there that are already be set up. And, you know, how long do you have to talk to this person? 5 minutes, 10 minutes? A lot of the workplace conversations are not going to be for an hour. So, you know, unless it's a lunch type thing, those, we talk about that, people, if you have to do a lunch or something of that nature. But I mean, yeah, if you can call in and chat with us, I think you should be able to do it. And you should have time to work on some of that while you, if you're still like a full-time student, or if that's taking up a lot of your time, you should have an opportunity to work on that. I don't know if you have mentors where you are enrolled who can help with some of that, either, as I said, an internship or getting you opportunities to kind of get a foothold so you can see what that world that you're going into, what it's going to look like if you don't already have an idea. Does that make sense? Does that seem logical?
Yes, sir. Thank you for the suggestions. And just another question for you or any of the other listeners. What would be a codified response to the question, why don't you smile that much? Because it seems that just a black male who doesn't smile is automatically angry.
That is very, very common. And I think some folks have been asked, some people might already have a codified response to that one, because we've heard that one a lot. And I mean, hey, we can even get into that. So what do you mean a lot? How much am I supposed to smile? Am I supposed to walk around smiling? You know, do we have a specific amount of hours a day of smile time? You know, what's a lot? I don't even know the ratio, you know. I do smile. I don't think anyone can say that they've never seen me smile. I smile. I chuckle. But generally speaking, about doing work, you get me that raise, I guarantee you, I will give you a big smile then. I get that raise. I get that extra week of paid vacation. I'll smile then. But till then, you know, I'm trying to work hard. We got goals. We got objectives, things to accomplish, hard work. That would be run right there. I didn't, you know, and that would be honest. That's why I said sometimes if there's any confusion, I just lean to the truth. Like, you know, that's in Nothing But a Man, classic workplace racism. I might have to play that next week. He gets asked that question exactly by a hostile, racist white man, the main character, black male. He's on the job, new there, and the white man makes some sort of racist joke, and all of the black people laugh, victims, they laugh. And the one victim, black male, he doesn't laugh. And the white, hey, you don't laugh? And he says, I laugh if it's funny. And the white man gets an attitude like, oh, it wasn't funny. You didn't think my joke was funny, huh? And it just goes from there. But yeah, that movie came out, I think, 60 years ago. So, I mean, that is super kind. That's brilliant codification to already be thinking of an answer to that question. Why don't you smile, boy? I would try and make that a short conversation, too. That would be one where it's going to be like less than 10 seconds. I talked too long before. It should be less than 10 seconds. But I got to spend a whole lot of time talking about the smiling or frowning nigger in the office. We have folks. One, if any of our engineer folks are here, you should not be a spectator since we have a black student who is requesting input for this field specifically. So any of our engineering folks, if you want to call in and tell him how he can make it, feeling like he's not the most chatty person and being able to survive in the corporate engineering environment in a system of white supremacy, if you all have any tips that can help him and some maybe some conversation help so he can kind of direct and get through that a little easier. And then if anybody, if you already got a codified response to, hey, why don't you smile more, Negro? If any folks have a response to that one, I think it should be 10 seconds or less, because that should be a short conversation. We shouldn't spend, I mean, we did not come in to talk about that. Look at my teeth or my gums or whatever else. Hey, short answer. Any folks want to respond to our previous first time caller? So I'm glad you called in first time. Any folks want to respond to our first time caller? Maybe we don't have our engineers with us today. I'll check back in to see if our engineers are listening. Or you can drop an email if you're not able to call, but should not be a spectator. Any of our black engineers, non-white engineers, if you have any suggestions for our engineer in training, that would be grand. And any folks, if you have thoughts on the answer to the question, why don't you smile more? That is so common. That should be shared as well. We'll get back to our first-time caller, sir. Thank you so much for sharing. Other folks that we missed totally, did you all have commentary?
Can I be heard?
Imhan DC, yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So I am not certified as an engineer or whatever the full process is to complete your degree. I haven't done that. However, I'm familiar with engineering. I can give an example of my uncle, who's an engineer. He's a professor. He smiles all the time. As a matter of fact, he's probably the most smiling person in my family. And I wonder if it has something to do with, you know, being an engineer and being under so much pressure with those white folk. But like I said, he smiles a whole bunch. He speaks a lot. So yeah, I don't know. Maybe as a black person, smiling might be part of the gig. I really don't know though. And with my uncle, I talked to him about white supremacy, talked to him about religion, talked to him about, you know, everything. But anyway,
I'm not really sure about the whole smiling thing. I would just, you know, tell them I'm a serious person. I came here to get the work done. But as I said, the examples I have, I know a number of like engineers, and a lot of them, you know, they most of the time they have a stern face, but when they speak, they try to speak really pleasantly. They do some smiling. I was going to speak about the workplace that I was in. I was speaking about the surveillance, how many cameras were in the different buildings of this workplace. As I said before, I was working with children who had mental problems, and they had cameras on every wall. If there's four walls, there's a camera on all four walls. But they have like rooms that can see into another room. So if you really want to count the number of cameras that will be looking at you at one time, it could be seven cameras looking at you. Seven cameras looking at you at one time. Like, what? Like, how many angles do you need? And like, I couldn't even go to the restroom and be in private. When you go to the restroom, I noticed my shadow was being cast behind me under the door. You can see whatever, who's ever in the restroom, you can see what they're doing. And I wasn't using the restroom. I was getting some privacy. And then I was like, oh, damn, I don't have privacy here either. But, excuse me. Oh, another thing with the surveillance. So I was speaking to one of the men who had been working there, for a black man who had been working there for, you know, six or more years. He excellent at his job. He didn't have to, you know, slam the children or put them in any holds in order to get them to cooperate. He cooked for the children. And that was, you know, and he was just the best worker in the place. And, you know, of course, better than me at the job, because I don't know what needed to be done and everything. But anyway, I was speaking to him, but I was, it got to a point where I was telling him, hey, I'm kind of uncomfortable continuing our conversation, you know, just given all the cameras and stuff. And he said, oh, don't worry, it doesn't have any audio. I'm sorry.
Can I get a quarter?
Sorry, okay. Thanks, someone.
So, yes, no problem. And so, he was saying that, you know, there's no audio to the cameras. And I was telling him, you know, hey, that's a lie. There's audios to these cameras. And, you know, if my cheap phone can, you know, they can put a microphone on my cheap phone, if I could find a microphone for, you know, less than $10. I think they put microphones on those very, very expensive cameras that are in those cases. And again, there was another situation. I was talking to one of the ladies, and then again, it got to the point where I was like, I started complaining again about the daggone cameras. And she goes, ah, don't worry about it. Most of them don't work. I'm like, what? What are they telling y'all? Those cameras do work. The cameras work and it has audio. But yeah, I thought that was dangerous. Dangerous to put cameras and audio devices all over, recording devices all over the workplace, and then tell all your black employees that, oh, none of the surveillance actually works anyway. So, you know, your conversation's not going to be picked up. Don't worry about that. We may not see some of your behavior. Like, what? Yeah. Oh, and the last thing I wanted to say was, whenever we were doing the training, and the lady had mentioned that the white female who was doing the training, she mentioned that
like were cemented to that. Racism was one of the factors that caused people to have the mental problems to where they have to be treated by the company, you know, in this facility. And I had made my, you know, I had said something or asked her about that statement, because what she had done, I try to be a little quicker. What she had done was, that's what she said, that breaks her heart right before she was saying all the different factors of what causes these mental problems. She was like, words are hard. And then she said, racism being one of the factors that causes mental problems. Before she said that, she asked us to name behaviors. And we were supposed to name behaviors, and she was going to write it on the board. One of the black females was like, well, what's a behavior? What's the definition? What's the behavior? And so the instructor, the white female, says she's not going to give the definition. She wants us to do the work or something along those lines. So she's not going to give the definition. She wants us to continue to yell out behaviors. So people are yelling out a whole bunch of words that are obviously not behaviors, if you understand what the definition is. And then so it got to a point where I just, you know, blurted out the definition. And I was saying a behavior is an action. It's something you do. And then the black female was like, oh, okay. But then after that, the white female had already, the white instructor had already made it simple that she was not going to give definitions. So then whenever she mentioned white supremacy, I made my comment saying, or excuse me, she mentioned racism being a factor to mental problems. I made my comment saying, after she mentioned that racism was a factor in mental problems, she asked, well, which demographic, which group of people is life expected to go, which group of people is the age of life expectancy supposed to go down? I know I mixed the words up. Which group of people is age life expectancy supposed to go down? Everybody said black men. Everybody figured it was black men after, you know, they just thought for a second. And then so I made my statement saying, well, is it likely that racism is the reason why black men are going to have a lower life expectancy as time goes forward? And I made a statement about the little games she played and that words are, that racism is the difficult first thing. But then I didn't ask her for a definition of racism. All that to say, I didn't ask her for a definition of racism because she had already strategized where she did plan. She was not going to answer any definitions or give any definitions to the words that she was using. Those are the things I wanted to mention. Thank you.
Much obliged, M. Hondisi. Whites not having definitions, not providing definitions, deliberately, willfully doing this, in my view, is one of the ways that you practice deception. I mean, in elementary school, I remember it was very common. If you don't have a definition for a term, you don't know what it means, you don't use the term. You're not reckless with words. And especially in this context, we're using these types of terms where everybody might have, or frequently people do have, very different definitions for these terms. We, at least for this context, want to have a common understanding of what we mean when we use these words. When that's not happening, that to me, that is a major red flag. We're not even about clarity. Doesn't mean that we have to have common agreement, but at least this is the way we're using the term. Other people may use it in a different manner, to at least have that as a baseline for some sort of understanding and having a logical discussion. The whole, we have these cameras here, they're installed, but there's no audio, and or many of them don't work. To me, that is, again, the primary
tactic of white supremacy racism is deception. I wouldn't care if they said all of the cameras are defective and there's no audio for any of them. I am, again, the same thing I said. I am going to assume that there will be a written transcript in about 100 different languages available online, audio recording, video recording, all of it in HD. It'll be on YouTube before the end of the day. That's the way that I'm going to function. That's the way that I'm going to talk. Same thing that I've said for years, regardless of what anybody else says. It's not going to be one of those situations where we're having a conversation where I'm uncomfortable. And we're going to continue. And I know they got 7 different cameras that are facing me from different. And I, come on. System of white supremacy. They did not pay all of this money to get these cameras and then to have them installed for no reason. That's not logical to think that way in a system of white supremacy. Let's see. Other folks are remembering, engineers, not be a spectator. Go ahead and dial in *61. Get your hand up if you have recommendations for our engineer in training. If folks have thoughts on the question, why don't you smile more to a black person in a work context? Are there folks that we have missed totally who have a hand up?
I may be here, Gus.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Gus. Good evening. I'm the school bus driver reporting from California. And a situation happened on my bus earlier this week where this young child, about 5 years old, came on the bus and yelled out at another student, "Hey, shut up, you taco." So I told her to knock it off. So she said, "Aren't you black? Aren't you a nigger?" And I just ignored her, you know. And then after I came to my stop and the other little non-white, non-black student got off the bus, she yelled at her, "Well, at least I'm not black. At least I am white." And I just shook my head. I said, "Oh my God, this is crazy." So, anyhow, and it's getting worse. And she did the same thing again today. So it's just something that I have to address with management. Because, and then she called. She asked me earlier in the week. She said, "Bus driver, have you ever eaten a goober chocolate?" I said, "No, I've never eaten any candy like that." She said, "Well, you sure look like you've been eating them because you look like a goober." Anyhow, man, you know, it's just getting worse. But thanks for letting me share, Gus, and you have a great night.
Much obliged, sir. Didn't we talk about the word goober last week? I'm real sure if it wasn't last week, it was this month. It was Autumn 2019. Where some white person on the job was calling other employees a goober. It was workplace racism specifically. It was the context. That term specifically, goober, it was just used. I'm not making that up. Anyway, I think that is also delectable Negro to have this white 5-year-old saying that you look like goober chocolate. Wow. Delectable Negro. I'll put that there again. That's so important. I would report that like immediately because they should have policy and procedure on what to do. They just had that big case in New York where those young girls, now they weren't 5, but they were like 10 and 11, where they terrorized that black child who was 10 and the bus driver didn't intervene. So I would bring it up in just that way with that report because that got so much attention. Like this just happened a few days ago. I don't want to be in that situation because she's getting on here and calling students taco and she called me a nigger. This is totally unacceptable. There has to be protocol for, you know, what to do to stop this. She should be reprimanded. I mean, you know, you do whatever you do for a five-year-old, but I mean, this is unacceptable behavior. They have punitive consequences even in kindergarten. They start suspending little five-year-old boys when they are 3 and 4. So she certainly can get a reprimand or get kicked off the bus, maybe make her parents have to take her to school. Because she can't terrorize other students and she can't terrorize the driver in that manner. So I would bring that report with that incident in New York and ask, what's the policy and procedure on dealing with this? Because this is totally unacceptable. It's endangering other students. Unsafe, that's the word. It is an unsafe driving environment to have her bullying and harassing other students on the bus to from school, and she's doing the same for me. That's not safe for me operating the vehicle if I'm going to have her racially terrorizing me while I'm trying to drive the vehicle. I would get what's the policy and procedure and get that rolling immediately. And first time, that's another first time, last time, like the first time it comes out when it's taco, like bang. If they got cameras on the bus, then that should be recorded. Like, oh yeah. And I can't emphasize that enough. We had at the courthouse in Florida, 4 years old, and the mother self reports, oh yeah, little Lacey got in trouble calling folks coon at the school, nigger and coon, in fact. This one, 5 on the bus. Hey, Taco, what, you say something to me, Buster? Aren't you a nigger? I'm white. You don't tell me what to do. You drive the bus, nigger. I'm 5. I'm white. Remember that. Now let's get back to 5. And they have the audacity to say that white people are ignorant about racism. Much obliged, sir. Let us know if you're able to get the protocol, what they say their policy is on addressing that, even for five-year-olds, because that's not a joke. That's a safety hazard of the highest order. And bam, I would have the article of that report in New York. That driver got charged with child negligence in that one. That can't be me. No, sir. Let's get this handled immediately.
I will, Gus.
Other folks have comments, questions, star 6-1, if we missed you totally.
Can I be heard?
Greetings, retired firefighter.
Greetings, Gus, and greetings to everybody else on the line. A PTA meeting would be a good place also to take that report, a report too, because parents would be quite concerned of the safety of their child on the bus, especially if someone else on that bus is compromising their safety. She is aware of colors, yes, someone that young could be a practitioner of racism, white supremacy. Take your phone out. If you're not, of course, if you're driving, you can't do it. But if you're at a stop or you're at a location, you know, like the school itself, and that person is, berating you in such a fashion, you know, you could just film the person and in turn turn that into the proper authorities, even the police. I'm pretty sure there's some resource officers somewhere around that are connected with the school itself. The question of why don't you smile? I wouldn't make it a debating session or anything. I'm not saying nobody did, but I'm just saying that from a standpoint of what my thoughts are. And at the same time, I would just say it's a matter of focus. I try to focus on what I'm doing. That's basically it as far as my answer would be to why don't you smile. It's just a matter of thought. at that particular point in time, while I'm at work, I'm focusing. I'm focusing on what? I'm focusing on what I'm here for. And for the most part, that's what I'm involved in, is some serious activity that requires me to be focusing on the task at hand. And, you know, just leave it at that. And most cases, the person would leave you alone, you know, as far as that concern. And then again, I mean, ignoring people is always a good option also, that I have utilized a lot. In other words, I wouldn't necessarily say it. I don't care what you think, but expressing it can be sometimes a good additive. And that person would probably just go on to the next person with their personal opinion about something. Yeah, those are my comments. I heard something earlier about literature on the job. I have an old war story. I think I mentioned it before. In the fire station, it's highly sociable, and there's a lot of additives that's in the firehouse that promotes conversation. I'm hearing someone else. I guess it's clear. Some stations have books, libraries even, magazines, hardcover books, paperback books, that sort of thing. And I would bring some literature of my own and to the station. Obviously, there was a coworker who was observing me personally and went on a call. And apparently, while I was on the call, he confiscated the book that I was reading and took it to a supervisor. The supervisor's rank was a chief. The chief that is in charge of the stations in the particular area. They call him a battalion chief. When I got back to the station to continue reading, I noticed it wasn't in the place where I put it at. And I was called to an office, and this person, the chief, had my book. It was Malcolm X speaking on, I forgot the subject. We're talking about something that was about 25 years ago. But anyway, so he put his understandings in the terms of a question by asking me, what if someone brought a book about racism to the station? And would that bother you? I said, no. As a matter of fact, I would ask them, can I read it when they finish with it? You know, as far as they, you know, as far as they're concerned. And I explained to him, to the chief, that I have a of my right to read a book based on the rules that the policies and the procedures of Dade County Fire Department, and basically the subject matter was closed the retired firefighter bringing a book to work. And that's it. I'll continue listening. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida, reading in the workplace. I said that for a long time. Whites are so nosy. Like, you really have to be mindful of that. Like, they will totally be like in your backpack or, you know, purse, whatever it is, to be like, oh yeah, let's see what this nigger is, you know, reading on the job. Like, they are all about that. You have to be, you know, cognizant.
under surveillance.
If I was playing a recorder where people can hear what is being said and whatnot, that's a different story. You know, that's it. Thank you.
Much obliged, much obliged. If there were a white person that brought a book to work on racism, I absolutely would want to read as well. That would not be cause for dissension. It would be, what is the author entitled, please, so that I can check this out in my leisure? Thank you. Thank you kindly. Anywho, other folks who dialed in that we have missed totally, if you have commentary to share, proceed.
Gus, can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, hi, Gus. This is Draftomania again. I just wanted to bring up the gentleman, the first-time caller. I'm not sure if that was the caller or not, the one that was sharing about the surveillance cameras. M. Hadisi was saying something about the workers were saying that the cameras wasn't working. We just had a situation over it was on the news recently where there was three black females that were arrested for mistreating and abusing some elderly women in a nursing home. I'm not sure if it got national coverage, but I wonder if they thought that the cameras were not working also. And yeah, that was an incident that just happened actually this week. And all three of the females, they were young black females, and they were all arrested and apprehended for mistreating elderly people in the nursing home. And I know this is workplace racism, but I wanted to bring up a suggestion for a book. The name of the book is called Our People. Not sure if you heard of it. Have you ever heard of the book?
No, ma'am.
It's called Our People. It is by, let me see. Give me one second. Our Kind of People. Inside America's Black Upper Class by Lawrence Otis Graham. And here that is a good book. I haven't read it. But I would be interested in seeing, you know, if we can read it or, you know, I'm not sure if they have an audio book for it. I think they do. I'm not really sure, but that was just a suggestion.
Much obliged. Thank you, Draftomania. Take that back. I have heard of the book. I just didn't remember the title. I have not read it, but a Cows listener actually saw him give a talk. His name stood out, Lawrence Otis Graham, because in like 2015, he wrote an article in the Washington Post about his son being terrorized at a mostly white school, and his son didn't want to talk about race. I think he said that was the strategy his son had developed. Like, it took something really traumatic, like some racists like drove by the campus and were like shouting and calling him a nigger and this sort of thing, and it really bothered him. And I think the school administration found out about it, so they were trying to do something, and then he felt, you know, bad, like, oh, you know, I'm the only black kid here, and now I brought this race thing up. And so it really bothered Mr. Graham, like, you know, what is he teaching his son about racism? Has he prepared him for what he's going to have to deal with? And blah, blah. Anyway, this is a really, really interesting article. He talked about it. The talk the Cows listener went to, they recorded it, and I was able to see it, actually. But yes, he also wrote that book, Our Kind of People, which is about that whole so-called upper class black, whatever that means. But that was how I found out about that book, was the irony hearing about what happened to his son. But yeah, that's Lawrence Otis Graham. Folks can check that out as well. I sent that book, a copy of that book, to a Cows listener. They asked me about it, and I was able to get it to them. Anywho, other folks that we missed totally, other folks that we have not heard from at all who have a hand up. Any folks that we missed completely? Do we get anybody? Yes, sir.
Yes. Good evening, Gus. Good evening, listeners, callers, and participants. I hope everybody's having a constructive evening. I was a caller who gave you the dilemma about the non-white supervisor and the black worker and the conflict that ensued. I was just giving you a brief update. Basically, what happened was what I expected. They have totally done away with that particular perk of paying that bonus for the time being. Is probably being reinstated at some point, but by the attention that's been given to it, it's been taken away from everybody across the board. So that's what happened. And to answer the young engineer's question, my answer may not be the best, but it's the one I've actually used, and I've gotten mixed results with it. Where they say, "Why don't you smile?" and say, "There's nothing to smile about." And some people want to pursue further, and some people won't. And I want to ask. I'll save the additional question, but the update I want to give, like, basically was that they've done away with the additional pay for the work that as a part of the conflict that happened that I tried to describe to you last week. I'll mute my line. Thank you.
Much obliged. Always appreciate the updates. I say that consistently. Thank you for the folks. If you dial in to share or email in to share, thank you for giving us an update that helps us adjust, you know, see what works, what doesn't. You don't want to waste time giving out, you know, faulty suggestions. But yeah, I'm not surprised to hear that they, you know, we don't even do this anymore. And that sort of thing should be made clear. In my view, I think that's another way that white supremacy racism is practiced a lot of times with overtime or any other sort of bonus or whatever it is. If it's going to be discontinued, it's done in a way that causes confusion and often in a way where the non-white person ends up thinking that they're going to get pay that they don't actually get. I've seen that happen. That tends to happen very, very frequently. So no surprise there. At least there's some sort of resolution, I guess. Let's see. We did have another email. Kizzy's cousin wrote in a couple of definitions, as you were unclear, and perhaps so were other listeners, of the meanings of some words I've used in earlier reports. Secondment, that is when I remember, the temporary transfer of an official or worker to another position or employment. Away day. A day on which employees meet at a venue away from the workplace to plan strategy or to discuss a particular issue. Never heard of that one either. You also asked about rewards for chairing the meeting where I was disregarded and interrupted. Technically, there were donuts and other snacks, but no pay rise. Donuts, man. Summary of racist antics for the week. Number one. I was leaving the office at lunchtime and saw an ex-colleague in the lobby area. I spoke with this person for a while, reminiscing about old times and talking about projects we're both working on. As we did so, the saboteur entered the lobby area and she was returning from her lunch break. I didn't notice her at first as I was engrossed in my conversation. I then noticed her hovering around, pretending to be looking at one thing, blatantly trying to listen in on my conversation. She was not very convincing. Under surveillance. Number two, I was eating my lunch. A suspected racist female came into the kitchen area and started making conversation about what I was wearing. Apparently, she has a dress made from the same material, just shorter. She then reached out to touch me. I successfully and subtly did a body swerve, which deterred her, the first time I've been able to use this tactic to stop people from touching me. She then asked me where I bought it. I lied. I told her it was a present from my daughter. The racist suspect's face turned hard and she shut down, then walked away. Hopefully that will be the last of her inquiries. Under surveillance. I do not go to really any environment and checking out white people's clothing. Oh, I got
a shirt like that, a pair of pants like that, that sort of fat. I mean, what in the world? And we've heard this from a number of listeners, particularly black females, talking about white women devouring, you know, every thread of what they wear, even sometimes copying what they're wearing on the job. Like, man, delectable Negro. I had intended to heat my food up on another floor where I'm less likely to see people I work around every day. I shall be putting this strategy into practice as of next week. I like that bit of code. Number three. Last week, I received an email out of the blue from a non-white person with a white parent, Cal Bell, who used to work for the same organization. This individual is clearly still in contact with the terrorists I work with. I used to advise and try to help this person get permanent work with the company, but I observed a few things that made me feel uncomfortable, so I kept my distance. The email was to inform me about the person's new job and mentioned racism at the new company. I was also asked to circulate a document. I've never mentioned racism to this individual, but they have brought it up in conversations. I've attempted to provide advice on how to manage the situations without getting into conversation about race. That is huge. I replied to the email. In my response, I congratulated the person on the new role and project, saying how exciting it all sounded. I ignored the comment about racism and asked for the document to be resent as I could not open it. I waited until this week to see if I got a response before reporting it on the COWS. I have not heard back or received the document at all. Very suspect. I agree. That's why I said, you know, I'm not talking to other non-white people about, you know, racism on the job. I'm not an advocate for that. They're a very suspicious planet, environment dominated by white supremacy. We don't have black people. We do not belong to a race. No one who is classified as non-white does. And so I just don't have that level of trust where I would share my views about white supremacy, racism. And again, not think that this is not going to be shared, reported to whites that might cause problems for me, jeopardize my employment. So, yeah, all of that is quite strange, especially if this person is bringing up racism and you have not talked about it. Unless I'm comfortable telling everybody in the company my views on racism when I speak to this person, I would have nothing to say about it. Not talking about racism directly anyway. Number four, a non-white female recently joined the company I work for. We used to work together at another company. I always tried to be supportive of other non-white people and was no different with her, particularly as I'd worked for the company for a while and she was on a temporary contract. Things were fine for a while at the old job until one afternoon there was a mix-up with catering ordered for a meeting she was holding. I was hosting a different meeting that was happening at the same time. The catering was delivered to my meeting by mistake. My coordinator was on leave that day, and I assumed she had made the arrangements as usual. Once the mix-up was highlighted, I called the caterers, and they delivered a fresh set of sandwiches within a half an hour. Bravo. I also apologized to the non-white female and thought everything was fine. Uh-oh. To my surprise, a week and a half later, she approached me at the desk I was allocated to question me about the mistake. I calmly explained the reason for the error, then just looked at her as she didn't get an emotional response, and I had more important things to focus on. She had to go back to her allocated desk. I realized she came for confrontation. Which irritated the hell out of me, not least because it was such a minor issue that had been quickly resolved, and up until that point, I had made an effort to support her. Since leaving that role, she has made attempts to contact me over the years, including through LinkedIn. I've ignored her, so it was my surprise when she emailed me this week to let me know she has started at the company where I currently am employed and asked to do lunch or a coffee. The email didn't mention any actual work-related matters, so I've ignored it. I'd welcome any thoughts on my approach from you and other COWS listeners. Number one, I can only say that is pretty saddening. This person wanted a confrontation, especially, you conclude like, wow, this person wanted to come and have, you know, some sort of gripe about sandwiches that were replaced pretty quickly. And would they have done this? Like if this had happened and it had been a white person's meeting, that got the sandwiches, and then they did the same thing, took, you know, maybe 30 minutes, realized what happened, and boop, got you fresh sandwiches. Would you have come to a white person to, you know, we're going to have a brawl about, you know, you stole our snacks? Mr. Fuller says frequently, this is the case. All of this is a result of white supremacy. Frequently, when we come in contact with other black people, it is for the purpose of confrontation. We are not coming to spread a little love. We are not coming to be helpful, constructive in any manner. It is show-offism and confrontation. That is frequently what it is. Unfortunately, not every time, but frequently that's what it is. Or even if it doesn't start out at that, that's where it will get to. Being mindful of that, and again, that's why I say it's so important to manage your emotions in the workplace. That is principle number one, the core of counter-racism in the workplace, really being in charge of your emotions and realizing when you get frustrated, if you need time or what have you, because so many of the situations are going to be about getting you upset and how you respond to that. Let's see. Finally, part two of my recruitment trainer report, I relayed the incident about the racist suspect trainer withholding constructive information from a non-white male to improve his interview skills. That afternoon, the panel I was part of also interviewed a racist suspect female. She was practicing her interview skills, and the panel was refreshing their knowledge on the company's recruitment procedures. My role was to observe the panel and give feedback on how they did. I deliberately chose to play this part as it gave me an opportunity to observe potential racism. The racist suspect female's interview was poor at best. She was obviously very nervous, but she also did not answer the questions properly. Whilst they did not score her as high as the non-white male, they pretty much gave her a score that would have meant that if it was a real interview, she would have been appointed in the role. I attempted to be balanced and ensure that both candidates were given constructive feedback that they could use in the future to secure jobs they are interviewing for. However, I first listened to their assessment and then I questioned them about their decision and their proposed feedback. She seemed to be flirting throughout the interview, which I think was a way of masking her lack of confidence and inability to provide a good answer. She is also quite young. Given there are predators such as Harvey Weinstein amongst us, I thought it was important to talk to her about working on her confidence, not mentioning anything about flirting, as it could affect her prospects. I've since thought about it, and I realized it didn't really matter, as they were happy to give her the role anyway. Bad interview notwithstanding. That, again, system of white supremacy, unqualified whites doing it, B-I-G, worldwide. That is really, in my view, that is a great move to get in that type of position where you could observe just to contrast the difference. We had the black male last week who was nervous but who had brilliant answers and who should have been given that feedback, but they didn't want to share that information with him. They got this unqualified, young, flirtatious white woman. And it's bravo, bravo, bravo. Best interview ever. To make sure I get to the question about how you respond to the black female who wanted to have confrontation before and now she wants to have a coffee or lunch or whatever it is. If it's not workplace related and this is someone who you have not had the most constructive relationship with before, I think ignoring is always fine. Minimize contact, that is the word. I think that's always acceptable. If, you know, things change and it seems like she's behaving in a more constructive manner and you all can talk and be pleasant and it doesn't seem like there's anything suspicious about it, fine. But that, again, Gavin DeBecker, The Gift of Fear. If your intuition is telling you that there's something awry about this and there's evidence, it's not like this is just based on nothing. Trust your instincts. No reason to respond. We got lots of other things to do with our time and energy in the system of racism. United, independent. If we missed you totally, don't wait till the last 5 minutes. We only have about 4 minutes. Many other folks have comments they want to make sure they get in before we get ready to conclude.
Yes. Just wanted to ask you, Gus, did you read my Facebook message?
Oh, got to go over and get to, I have not. I'll have to go check my Facebook. I've been slacking on my social media messaging.
Okay. It's just a book suggestion. That's all it is. Paul Robeson. I mentioned him before months ago, and he certainly would not fit into that negative stereotype that you were rightfully speaking about. I forgot the name of the title. I can bring it up again, but I can bring up the exact title of the book. I just don't have it in my mind right now.
I will definitely check it, and that would be a quality book to add. We're voting. You vote by Tuesday if you have a selection for books. Quite a few to choose from. Got even two more this evening. Folks have a thought for a new book, especially if you would like to narrate. I think they had some sort of review on Paul Robeson's film career this weekend. It might be in the compensatory call-in tomorrow. I have to double check, but they were just talking about him in great depth just this very week. Anything else folks need to get in before we conclude? I would assume folks are satisfied. Document. Assume all of the cameras are working and assume there are probably more cameras there. I was even with the bathroom. They were even saying that they had technology. I remember I played that some time back. That was supposed to be some sort of app so they could see how long you were taking in the bathroom, how many hours were being wasted with employees being in the bathroom. Like, whew, man. 2020, System of White Supremacy. All of that should serve as motivation for why we want to get this problem solved immediately. We'll be here tomorrow for the compensatory call-in, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. We'll be here on Tuesday, October 22nd. Dr. Ruby Lathan returns. We'll be a hoot to hear from her. If you have food questions that you'd like to ask, recommendations, things about health, nutrition, Tuesday, always grand to have Dr. Lathan on the program. And folks, particularly parents, looking to try to make sure they're sharing quality foods with their children. I want to make sure I ask her about that myself this Tuesday. With that, much obliged for everyone participating. I hope it was worthy of your Thursday evening. We'll be here in about 24 hours. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Let's do all that we can to preserve our brain computers so that we can come up with new concepts that will permanently solve the problem. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled up every time we are in a vehicle, passenger or driver. Let's do all that we can to minimize contact with race soldiers, badge or no. If you are driving, no cell phone. Trying to do the little things that we can to try to stay as safe as possible under extraordinarily hostile terroristic conditions. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Yoga retreat in Florida, December 28th to January 1. Price lowered to $730. Deposit $380 due next week. Final deposit, second week in December. We will see you in Florida. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.